By the causes mercy of Guru and Gauranga, we are hearing from Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam, which is the literary incarnation of Krishna himself. Just as Sri Krishna appears among the aquatics as Matsya Avatar, the fish incarnation, He appears among the mammals as Varahadev, the boar incarnation. He appears among the devatas, the demigods, as Vamandev. So, similarly, see Krishna, Shyam Sundar, Prajanda Nandan, appears amongst the Granthas, all the scriptures. And that incarnation is Srimad Bhagavatam. It is so extraordinarily powerful. Duru Adbhuta Viragesmin Sadadu Reis to Panchaki. Yatta Sopapi Sambandha Satyam Bhava Jandane. The mind, the intelligence, any type of calculation or worldly experience cannot enter into it, cannot understand the extraordinary power of Srimad Bhagavatam that even a person who has not developed proper Shraddha, faith, if they are touched by the air of this Katha, if they are not critical or hypocritical, they are an offenseless person, then at once, simply by hearing the sound of Srimad Bhagavatam, bhav, that is ecstatic emotional love for Sri Krishna, can appear in the heart. The pastimes of Sri Krishna himself directly are described in Srimad Bhagavatam in the 10th canto. There are 90 chapters in the 10th canto, and of those 90 chapters, only 39 take place in Vrindavan. Alas! And then the rest take place in Mathura and Dwarka and other places. Sometimes Krishna travels to other places like Mithila or Prabhas. So, Srimad Bhagavatam Puranamamalam Yad Vaishnavanam Priyam. This is, Srimad Bhagavatam is so dear to the Vaishnavas. And especially, yesterday we discussed how the contribution of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is that he revealed this Srimad Bhagavatam is unlike any other scripture. Dharmaha prajito kaita vatra kritibi. Dharma prajito kaita vatra paramo nirmatsaranam satam vedyam vastavam attavastu shivadanta patrangulam Srimad Bhagavate Mahamune krite kimva para ishvara so sadyo vritya vrutite atra kritibisu susabhistatjana. In the second verse of Srimad Bhagavatam, Srila Vyasadeva is saying, Dharma prodita kaitavo atra. Atra means here. Here, in this. In this scripture, Srimad Bhagavatam, all types of cheating have been rejected. That means all types of worldly motivations for enjoyment in this life, enjoyment in heaven, and especially of all types of cheating. Kaitava pradhan, what is that? Mukti vancha. The desire for liberation. Nirvana, mukti moksha. Sayujya, that the soul will get out and then being the light of Brahman forever. This, of all types of cheating, this is the worst. Why? Because even though you become free from the influence of the material energy, you still have complete indifference to the spiritual energy and to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. How terrible is that? So the desire for liberation and the processes of liberation, they've been kicked out, rejected from the Srimad Bhagavatam. Nibrita Marun Manoksha Drida Yogi Jogridyan Munyaru Upaste Tara Yogi Yeros Maranat. In the end of the 10th canto, the Vedas personified, they say, what's the point of doing intense yoga sadhana, controlling your breathing and controlling your mind in order to try to get liberation, when even demons who hate Krishna and want to kill him, they get that same liberation. So what's the use of that? That you have dedicated all your time and effort to attain the same goal that demons attain, who Bruder, du hast dich an Thomas erkannt. So, soon about that, kids will be spending their daughter and her party to kite the uptrap. Paraholi matsaranam satam. And this scripture, it is for those who are paraholi matsaranam. The sadhus who have no envy of anyone. Heart is free from envy. If there's a scale, an envy is at this end, love is at that end. So as long as there's envy in the heart, there cannot be any love because they are antithetical. They're diametrically opposed. In fact, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur explained the 10 types of Nalaparat, they're just 10 different kinds of envy. Envy of Guru, envy of Shastra, envy of devotees, envy of the process of Bhakti, by elevating the path of karma above it. The enmity. So, but this scripture is beneficial for everyone, but it's especially for those who are paramahamsas. Because even the liberated souls, they benefit by hearing the scripture. So what kind of text is that? That means that every syllable of Srimad Bhagavatam is saturated with rasa. Pibhata bhagavatam rasamalayam muhuraho rasika buvibhavukaha. Those who are already liberated, those who are rasik, those who are bhavuk, those who are expert in relishing the transcendental mellows, oh, just wait until you hear the Srimad Bhagavatam. Then you'll be able to relish in an unprecedented way that you have never experienced before. The Mahabhava of Brajagopis, the Madanakya Mahabhava of Srimati Radhika has been glorified in Srimad Bhagavatam. Vedam vastavamatra vastu shivadam tapa trayunmulanam. The Srimad Bhagavatam will uproot the cause of all suffering. That is avidya, our ignorance. Every problem that you have in your life doesn't require an individual solution. We just have to hear the Srimad Bhagavatam and it will solve all the problems simultaneously. Srimad Bhagavate Mahamune Krite. The Srimad Bhagavatam was composed by the Mahamuni. Then people become confused. They think, oh, Vyasadeva is glorifying himself. And Srila Vyasadeva wrote this verse and he's saying it's composed by Mahamuni, the great Muni. Vyasadeva said, no, I am not the great Muni. Krishna himself is Mahamuni. Muni means one who is deeply absorbed in meditation on the highest transcendental reality. So see Krishna, whether he's awake or whether he's asleep, whether he's eating or dancing or taking the cows to graze or meeting with his parents or playing with his friends, Krishna's always meditating on the highest truth. Srimati Radhika. He never forgets her for a moment. Ever. Never. Even if his life is threatened, even if he's in danger, there is nothing that can penetrate the density of his Radha Prem. So therefore Krishna is the Mahamuni. And to reveal these truths about himself and about his highest pastimes in Vrindavan, he himself appears again and again in different forms to reveal Srimad Bhagavatam. Yesterday we discussed that. Tadrupena Narada Munaye Krishnaya Tadrupina Yogindraya Tadatmatata. It is Krishna who reveals Bhagavatam to Brahma. Then Krishna appears in the form of Brahma to reveal it to Narada. And Krishna appears in the form of Narada to reveal it to Vyas. Whenever the Bhagavatam is manifested in this world, it's Krishna himself who does it. Therefore, Srimad Bhagavate Mahamune Krite. Kimva para Ishvara. What is the need of any other scripture? So actually our Goswamis have written so many beautiful texts, like Bhaktirasamrita Sindhu and Gujanila Mani. So we don't say that we should not read them. But here, in poetry it's expressed, what's the need of any other scripture? Because simply hearing the Srimad Bhagavatam will transport you in your beautiful spiritual body to Goloka Vrindavan. And when you're there, then you won't need any scripture. Once you're there. Now you're there. You directly serve Radha and Krishna. You cannot tell Radha and Krishna just wait, I have to read one more chapter. So Kimvapara Ishvara, Sadgo Vidya Rudatev Tukativisus Rusavisat Sarat. At once, the heart becomes filled with love and captures Krishna. So in this verse we see the word Atra, Atra, Atra. Dharma Prajita Kaita Vatra. Sadgo Vidya Rudre Atra. Atra, again and again. Vidyam Vastavam. Atra. Shivanam Tapatra Mulanam Atra. So the reason yesterday I keep saying Atra, 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 Atra. Here, here, here. Here in this Srimad Bhagavatam defines the exclusivity of this scripture. In other words, the power and the experience you will get from hearing Srimad Bhagavatam is Atra, Atra, Atra. It's only here, it's here, and you will not find it anywhere else. Yet we see, in the 10th canto, which is the smiling face of Krishna, 39 chapters speak of beautiful Vrindavan Leela, and then the other 51, all Mathura and Dwarka Leela. Alas, alas. But don't lament too much. Because Shukadeva Goswami, being very rasic, he has spoken this katha to invoke feelings of separation. Nadi nadi pralambina sambhoga pushtimashtunti. Without separation, the joy of meeting cannot be increased to its highest relish. So it should be understood that in the cause of each and every pastime of Krishna in Mathura and Dwarka is his love for Vrindavan, his love for the residents of Vrindavan, and especially his love for Srimati Radhika. You know that after Krishna had killed Kamsa Maharaj in Mathura, then he told his father Nanda Maharaj, please return to Braj. I will come just quite soon. But for now, I will have to stay here because Vasudev, his son is Balaram, and in his whole life he never saw his son. If you will see him for a few days and then lose him again, he will die. And if I leave Balaram here and go without him, then I will die and Balaram will die because we cannot live without each other. So the two of us will stay here for a short time and then we'll satisfy our friends here in Mathura, and then we'll return to Braj. So with a heavy heart, Nanda Maharaj returned to Braj Gokul. And now Krishna and Balaram are staying in Mathura. And everyone is thinking, Krishna and Balaram are the son of Vasudeva and Devaki. They are not cowherd boys. Why? Because on the wedding day of Devaki, there an Akashvani, an aerial voice, said, you fool Kamsa, you don't know the eighth child of Devaki will kill you. And then, almost 11 years later, in the Ramshala, in the wrestling arena, in the stadium of Kamsa Maharaj, right there before everyone's eyes, everyone saw this cowherd boy who would come from Vrindavan with Nanda Maharaj kill Kamsa. Everyone saw it with their own eyes and they jumped up and exclaimed, he must be the eighth child of Devaki. And then all the Yadus surrounded him and took him away. They wanted him to forget all this dairy farm business. All this taking the cows to graze. Forget that. Now you are of the royal family. You are Vyadu dynasty. You are Kshatriya. So Vasudeva Maharaj, he wanted to have Krishna initiated. That is called the Upanayan Sanskar, the sacred thread ceremony. And each caste, whether they are Brahmins, Vaishya, Kshatriyas, not Sudras, Sudras don't have Upanayan Sanskar sacred thread. But the highest three castes, they're called Dvija, twice born. And they receive the sacred thread. After that, they can study the Vedas under the guidance of their guru. So each caste has a ritual or a ceremony which is different in which the thread is given. So Vasudeva Maharaj was thinking, when I do the samskar, I arrange for Gargacharya to give the Brahma Gayatri to Krishna. According to these rules, then Krishna will have the samskar, the impression, and he will understand, I am not a coward boy. I am a Kshatriya, I am a warrior, I am of the royal family, and I belong here in Mathura. So, Vasudeva Maharaj was wanting to arrange for this. At that time he thought, oh, I should invite Rohini to come, because Rohini is the mother of Balaram, and she was still in Braj. So, he wrote a letter, and he sent it with a messenger to Braj. So Nanda Maharaj received the letter and he read it to Rohini. Vasudeva Maharaj said, when Nanda Maharaj was returning to Braja, I didn't think of it at that time, but now the danger of Kamsa Maharaj is over, Rohini should return to Mathura. Because Rohini is the wife of Vasudeva. And because Kamsa Maharaj had put Devaki in jail, he thought that Rohini, she's also my wife, and she's also pregnant. So Vasudeva, then Kamsa Maharaj may commit atrocities against her, so he secretly sent her to live with Nanda Maharaj. But now the danger is over, it's time for her to come back to her home in Mathura. So when Rohini received this news, she was devastated. She said, what can I do? On the one hand, I cannot disobey my husband, Vasudeva Maharaj. On the other hand, I cannot deny that I have a strong desire to go and see Krishna and Balaram. But how can I give up my dearest friend, Yashoda? Yashoda is in the darkest hour of her life now, having lost her son. All day she's just crying. She cannot see. She hardly moves. How can I leave her? And Rohini was begging, oh Brahma, oh Creator, the only way I could solve this problem is if you made two of each one of my limbs, and in one form I could stay with the Shoda, and in one form I could go to Mathura. Hearing her lamentation and feeling her pain, though Mother Shoda was in more pain, but this is the nature of those who have bhakti. They're like a tree. The tree is burning in the blazing sun but giving shade to others. Mother Yashoda said, oh my dear Rohini, the Creator has already made your two bodies. Why? Because we are one Prana. You and I are one Prana. But we have two bodies. Your body is one body and my body is the other, but we are the same. So, you should go there. And if you will go and you will see Krishna and Balaram, then it will be exactly as if I have been and seen Krishna and Balaram. And when you see them, then that will give relief to me. So then astrologers, they calculated an auspicious time to leave Braj. I don't know how you do that. What calculation that is, I have no idea. But they calculated an auspicious time to leave and they loaded a bullock cart with so many gifts of makhan and mishri and yogurt and sweets for Krishna. And they put Rohini on the chariot, on the bullock cart. And then, with tears in her eyes, she set off for Mathura. Gradually she came. And she arrived in Mathura. When she arrived there, Krishna and Balaram came and they fell at her feet, weeping. And because in Mathura they have no one to speak to. To whom can they express how they are missing Vrindavan and the love of the Vrindavasis? No one in Mathura can understand. But finally now someone has come who has lived through the glorious days of Krishna's babyhood, Krishna's childhood, Krishna's youth. Rohini Maya, she understands everything. So they fell at her feet and she bent down and lifted them and embraced them. And at that moment, all three, Krishna, Balaram and Rohini, had the same experience. They all had an intense spurti of Madhya Shoda there, smiling and blessing them. This is why the Sadhu Sangha is so powerful. Because when those devotees who feel separation from Krishna or from their Gurudev, when they meet each other, just their association causes the spurti of the Ishtadev. I remember when my Gurudev used to meet with his godbrother Srila Tripurama Maharaj after not seeing him for a whole year. You know, they would see each other and give pranams and they were weeping. Why? Because they were having a sporty of Srila Bhakti Pragyan Kesha Maharaj, their Gurudev, who had left so many 30 years before. So when we come together with Vaishnavas and we feel separation, then the love creates the impossible experience of the presence of those personalities. So Krishna and Balaram and Rohini, all they felt the presence of Madhya Yashoda there. Then Rohini, she was speaking with Vasudeva and Devaki and other members of the Yadu dynasty and saying, oh, how very wonderful it was in Gokul. But Vasudeva and Devaki were silent, they were not saying anything. The residents of Mathura, by and large, they have some indifference towards Vrajvasis. So then, seeing that the situation was a little bit icy, so then some of the ladies of the palace, they said, oh Rohini, you're just talking about that coward village because you like the taste of the butter and the yogurt there. They tried to lighten up the atmosphere a little bit. Then she realized, I can't speak about Vrindavan here. The atmosphere is not conducive to that. So then Vasudeva Maharaj, he told Krishna and Balaram, in a few days, it will be your Upanayan Sanskar. So then Krishna wrote a letter to Nanda Maharaj. Because he knew if he will get the news, then his heart will be broken. Why? Because the father is raising the son. And he's raising the son, the boy 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. And for coward boys, they have to take the Upanayan Sanskar when they're 11. But Krishna left Braj when he was 10 years old and 9 months. So Nanda Maharaj was robbed of his paternal opportunity to arrange this for his son. So Krishna knew how painful the news would be to Nanda Maharaj. So he said, what can I do? So he wrote a letter. Oh, Pitasri, my dear father, now Vasudev Maharaj, he is arranging my Upanayan Sanskar. So externally I am going through this ceremony by which I become a twice born Kshatriya. But you should know that in my heart I am never a Kshatriya. I am always Gopal. And I will always be Gopal. So I don't accept it. Mantra will be given, the ceremony will be performed. But inwardly I don't accept it. Then how will this be, Upanayan Sanskar? Sri Krishna said, my dear father, my cowherd boyfriends, who are my age also, and have now become of the age for their upanaya sanskar. They are my pran, they are my life and soul. They are none different from me. So on the same day, at the same time, you should arrange the upanaya sanskar for them. And they will be my representative. Through them, you are doing my upanaya sanskar. And when I in Madhura say, Om Baram, and take my vow, then my vow will be true because my real upanaya sanskar is going on at the same time in Braja. In this way, our very soft and sympathetic and compassionate Krishna saved the life of that Maharaj. After receiving Brahma Gayatri, now it's time for the boy to have his Vedic education. So Krishna and Balaram was thinking, now we have to go to Gurukul. Which Gurukul shall we go to? There are so many qualified sadhus, like Vyasadeva, like Narad. But I think we cannot go in the Gurukul. Why? Because they're Vaishnavas. And Vaishnavas know Eteta Amsa Kalapamsa, Krishna's true Bhagavan Swayam. Then how will they accept us as a student in their school and give us discipline and make us serve them and all of these things? They'll feel uncomfortable. So we should find someone who has realized Brahman and has all the Brahmanical qualities and being the Gurukul of that person. So they knew that there was one great Brahmin. He was from Kashi. And he had spent some time in Pravas also. But now he had established his Gurukul in Avantipur. That is Ujjain. It's about 600 kilometers from Mathura Brajmana. So, Krishna and Balaram decide we should go in his Gurukul because he's a Shivite. And he will not recognize us, he will not know who we are, and he will treat us really like real students so we can have a genuine Gurukul experience. So then Krishna and Balaram, they were thinking, but wait a minute, now we killed Kamsa Maharaj, Jarasandha, and Dantavakra, and so many demons, they want to take revenge on the Yadu dynasty. And if they know that we're away from Mathura, they'll definitely take advantage and try to make a massacre. So we should pretend that we're not going anywhere, that we're here in Mathura. So then Krishna and Balaram, they announced to everyone that for several months they will be doing austere vows and they will stay only inside their room in the palace and not go anywhere. So then everyone was fooled. Everyone thought Krishna and Balaram, they're doing austerities in their room, no one's to bother them for a few months. But secretly, they snook out of Mathura and they set out on foot for Avantipur. They had to go on foot because now they're brahmacharis. They have shaved heads. They have dandas made of the wood of the kadir tree. They're dressed in deer skin. They have rings made of kush grass and they thread. They look like very pukka brahmacharis. And brahmacharis are not allowed to travel in any vehicle. They have to go everywhere by foot. So they set off on foot, walking 600 kilometers. No one recognized them. They were going through villages. And when they went through the cowherd villages, where cowherd boys were taking the cows to graze in the fields, then they were feeling such ecstasy. Remembering the good old days, when they could play with their friends in the forest of Vrindavan, and take care of their beloved cows. Sometimes they went in the village, and there were cowherd girls in the village, gopis of whichever, not of Vrindavan. And when the young village girls were collecting water in their pots, saw these two brahmacharis, their eyes became bigger. They had to cover themselves. They became shy. And they spoke with each other. Oh, some young lady is going to be very fortunate in the future. In the future, this beautiful young man will rest his head in the lap of a woman. She will be more fortunate than Lakshmi Devi. And he may decorate her body with his own hand. And they were thinking of these things and speaking to each other. And when Krishna overheard it, he was in great bliss. And then suddenly he realized, oh, I'm a brahmachari. And he covered his ears. I shouldn't listen to this. In this way he continued, and gradually they approached the Avantipur. There, Sandipani Muni was sitting like the moon among so many stars. He had thousands of effulgent Brahmin students, and they're all sitting and learning Vedas and Vedangas from Sandipani Muni. Krishna and Balaram arrived there. They were carrying wood in their hands. Tasmat gurum tadvijnanartham sagrum eva abhigachat samit panisrutram brahmanishtam. One must approach the spiritual master carrying wood for sacrifice in one's hands. So Krishna and Balaram, they came into that assembly carrying the wood in their hands, and their effulgence outshone the effulgence of all the brahmanas. But the brahmanas could see from their physique that they were very strong, that they were not brahmanas. So knowing that they were, suspecting that they were Kshatriyas, but they were not brahmanas, then all the boys, they said, we're brahmanas, we don't have to stand up. We don't have to stand up and give respect to these two people who are coming there from a lower caste. But at the same time, though they had some pride in their brahminical status, when they looked at Krishna and Balaram, their hearts were melting. And they couldn't understand why. Krishna and Balaram introduced themselves, but because it was secret, they didn't say their names. They only told their varna, we are Kshatriyas. They told their gotra, we are of the Yadu dynasty. And I am, Balaram is the fair one, and Krishna is the dark one. So they're only known as the fair Yadu and the dark Yadu. So they offered the wood, and they gave pranams at the feet of Sandipani Muni. And then with folded hands they begged him. Oh great perfected personality, you are an ocean of mercy. Kindly accept us and deliver us from the suffering of ignorance. When Sandipani Muni saw them, he was very inspired. And he said, with affection, my dear boys, the time for study is very rare and very precious. So you should stay in my Gurukul for a long time, as long as you can. This is true. When you are young, you may not appreciate. But when a time comes in your life when you can just study, you can be absorbed, you can read a lot, you can discuss, you can hear from others, learning persons. What opportunity! This is a great opportunity. It does not come to everyone. And if it comes to someone, it may come just for a year or a few years of their life. And then what happens? The gunas start moving, and then we become entangled in so many activities. Then you can study. Actually, so much. Because to study you need a vesh, to be absorbed, to be fully absorbed. Then you can go deep, deep into the shastra. So Sandipani Muni said, the time for study is rare and most precious. So study. Now stay with me as long as you can. So he accepted them and he told them, you have to give up this abhimana of being Kshatriyas. So for this, you have to do bhiksha. You have to go begging. You know, because warriors, royal family, they never beg. Never. So then Krishna sent them out. The Sanyabhani Muni sent Krishna and Balaram out with the other Brahmins. And they were going from door to door and begging. So they would go and they would request something. But when Krishna and Balaram went to any door, when the persons opened the door, only seeing them, without anyone saying anything, their hearts just melted and they just grabbed their most precious things and just gave everything. And the other boys were thinking, how successful they are in this bhiksha seva. This is always a bhiksha. They couldn't understand. So in this way they were staying in the Gurukul. And even the students who were very senior and had studied so much, Krishna and Balaram surpassed them. In only a few days, listening, they heard once and they remembered everything. So everyone was very impressed with them. And Krishna and Balaram, they liked to do service secretly when no one was looking. One day, Guru Mata, the wife of Sanyabhani Muni, came to her husband and she said, out of all your students, who is the most dedicated, the most devoted? Sanyabhani Muni said, those two Kshatriya boys, they are the most dedicated. I have never seen anything like it. His wife said, but I don't see them serving you. He said, yes, I've forbidden them. That they should not serve me directly. But they're always watching and listening, and whatever is needed, they do so many services all the time. In a way that you don't notice. So one day, the wife of Sanyabhani Muni, she looked and she saw, oh, it looks like rain will come. And so we need to get some wood and bring it before everything gets wet. So she came to the boys and she said, oh boys, we need to collect some wood. The boys said, oh Guru Mata, it looks like really heavy rain is coming. I don't think it's a good idea. So they didn't go. But she didn't ask Krishna and Balaram, but Krishna and Balaram went in and they just overheard. So then Krishna just, and they got up and they went out to the forest, not being asked. These are the different types of disciples, you know. The first class, the third class disciple, Guru tells the disciple to do something, but he doesn't do it. The second class disciple, Guru tells something to do, and he does it. And the first class disciple, Guru doesn't even tell him, and still he does it. Like Rupa Goswami, Sri Chaitanya Manubhishtam, Stahapitanya Bhutale. He understood the innermost heart's desire of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And fulfilled that. Mano Krishna Seva. So Krishna and Balaram, they went into the forest and they were collecting wood, and then there was a huge storm. And everything was flooded, they couldn't return. And then, the next morning, Sanyabhani Muni found out and he chastised his wife. Why did you send them out? It was very dangerous. And without remembering his mantras, without remembering Gayatri in the morning, or taking bath or doing any of his duties, he just got some students and went out into the forest, searching for Krishna and Balaram. So the boys found Krishna and Balaram first. And Krishna and Balaram were laughing and joking with the boys. And telling them, oh, how they passed the night in the forest, trying to find shelter from the rain. But then when Sanyabhani Muni arrived there, then Krishna and Balaram became silent. And they gave their wood to their Gurudev and bowed down at his feet. And Sanyabhani Muni was thinking, they don't care for their own comfort, for their own safety, for their own luxury. They are completely selfless. They have no duplicity at all. They have served only for my happiness. And he blessed them. May all transcendental knowledge appear in your heart. how we attain divine realization. Only by the blessing of Guru Pada. At night, Krishna and Balaram would lie together on the ground in the Brahmachari ashram. And Krishna, he said to Balaram, I can't forget Vrindavan. To forget Vrindavan, I try to remember Mathura. I try to remember Devaki. But when I try to remember Devaki, or I hear the word mother, only Yashoda appears in my heart. When I try to remember Vasudeva, but Nanda Maharaj appears more strongly. When I try to remember the boys of the royal family, the boys, my friends in the Yadu dynasty, then I see Subal, Sridhar, Arjun, Labanga, Stoka, Krishna, Madhumanda. What can I do? Bahram said, yes. I also feel like I should just abandon everything and run away. Just run away from Gurukul, run away from Mathura, and go back to Braja. But we'll have to show restraint. Oh Krishna, it's my experience that when I just think of Nanda Maharaj and Yashoda and the other residents of Braja, they appear before me. And it's real. It's not my imagination. Krishna said, yes, I have that experience too. And Krishna and Balaram embraced each other, they were crying. And they fell asleep. Krishna in his sleep, he saw that he was on the bank of Jamuna. Radhika was there, Lalita, Vishaka, Chitra, Pakalata, and so many gopis. And they were dancing in Rasalila. He was full of joy. When they became tired and covered in perspiration, gopis were embracing Krishna and the kumkum from their bodies smeared all over his garland. And then taking their hands, he entered into the water of Jamuna to play with them. And then the next moment, Krishna woke up and saw, alas, alas, I'm not on the bank of Jamuna. There's no Rasalila. I'm here with the shaved head lying on the floor in a Brahmachari ashram, far away in Avantipur. Was feeling more and more separation from Vrindavan. Then the next moment he breathed and his body was fragrant with the aroma of kumkum of Radhika. He immediately became embarrassed. He thought, what if the other brahmacharis smell me? What will they think? He said, alas, now my vow of brahmacharya has been broken. And then he thought, oh, but I did not do it intentionally. So there's no fault on my behalf. And anyway, perhaps this night has saved the life of Srimati Radhika and the gopis of Vrindavan. Why? This is called the Vishesh Gona Sambhog. There are different types of meeting, Mukhya Sambhog and Gona Sambhog. So the secondary type of meeting is the meeting that takes place in dreams. But I may have a dream of you, but you don't know. Or you may have a dream of me and I don't know. But when two people have a dream and they both know, that's not ordinary. So that's called Vishesh. Vishesh Gona Sambhog. And it's a real meeting, but it's only known to those who experience it. And by that meeting, the life of Radhika and Prajagopis was saved. So gradually, Krishna completed learning 64 arts in Gurukul, and it was time for his graduation ceremony. So at the graduation ceremony, All the villages, everyone in the, not a village, quite a big city actually, Avantipur, they were invited to come and attend the graduation ceremony of Krishna and Balaram. You know, so at that time the guru does abhishek of the disciple. That is, he does a snan, a bathing. So that indicates that when you graduate from your education, you are nishnat. That means you are now bathed in the transcendental knowledge. So when the ceremony was over, there were huge crowds of people watching. And Krishna and Balaram, they approach their Gurudev, and before they can leave the Gurukul, they have to give a dakshina. So they said, "Oh Gurudev, please tell us, what dakshina would you like?" So then Sandipani Muni, he conferred with his wife and came back and he said, "Can you return to us our eldest son who disappeared in the ocean?" So then Krishna and Balaram with folded hands, they said, "Oh, this is the nature of great souls. That even though they are serving others, but they never request a lot of service from their own servants. They are very humble and they request a small thing." The Krishna and Balaram didn't think this was a very big request. And so they glorified the humility of Sandipani Muni and his wife. So then Krishna and Balaram, they tightened their belts. Said, "Okay, brother, Bhaiya, let's go." So they got on a chariot. So the son of Sandipani Muni had disappeared in the ocean at Prabhas. It's about 800 kilometers away from Avantipur. So they got on a chariot and very swiftly they drove and they came to the shore of the ocean. And when Krishna and Balaram saw the ocean, they were amazed. It was the first time in their life that they'd ever seen the ocean. So I don't know if you remember the first time that you ever saw the ocean. Right? It's so big. They thought, look, the ocean's coming to embrace us. Because so many waves are coming one after another. And the ocean is looking at us with eyes in the form of turtles. Because the turtles are coming up. Like eyes opening and closing in the water. And they were thinking, now how can we find the son of our Gurudev? So just then, Samudradev, the god of the ocean, appeared from the waves and came before Krishna and Balaram with folded hands. And he bowed down. He said, "Oh Bhagavan, oh Krishna and Balaram, I have received instructions about your greatness from Varunadev, the god of water. He told me," he said, "Hey Samudradev, salty ocean. There are so many oceans, you're just one of them, don't forget. You know, there's a milk ocean, there's the alcohol ocean, there's ghee ocean, there's yogurt ocean. In the universe there's so many different oceans." So Varunadev said, "You're a salty ocean. And there's so many other oceans. The sweet water ocean also." He said, "But you should know, there's only one ocean of mercy. And that ocean of mercy is Krishna. And he's not like any other ocean, in the sense that every ocean has a boundary. But this ocean of mercy, Krishna, has no end in any direction." So in this way, repeating the instructions of Varunadev, Samudradev offered prayers to Krishna and begged, "Oh, how can the servant of your servant serve you?" Krishna said, "Oh, some years before, the eldest son of my Gurudev, he was lost in the ocean. So we want to retrieve him. This is our Guru Dakshina." So then Samudradev, he said, "Oh, he was captured by a demon named Panchajana. He's like a serpent with a conch shell." So Krishna told Balaram, "Oh my dear brother, please wait here on the chariot." And Krishna dived into the ocean and was swimming looking, where is this Pancha? Pancha Jana. So he was swimming here and there, and then he saw that demon. And so demons, they naturally have enmity towards Krishna. So Pancha Jana attacked Krishna in exactly the way, same way that Bakasura attacked Krishna. You know, Bakasura tried to bite Krishna and he actually swallowed him. And when Krishna was in the throat of Bakasura, all the coward boys who were there, they fainted. Even Balaram fainted. And he knows all Tattva. So how much he was overwhelmed by the sweetness of Vrajalila. So just as Bakasura swallowed Krishna, so Shankarachuda also swallowed Krishna. But what happened? In both cases, they felt a burning in their throat. See, the Rupa Goswami has explained, Sat Krishna Nama Charitadi Sattva Vidya Pito Patasya Rasanasya Narojikanu Kim Tvatana Anudinam Kavusai Vajusta Swadvikramad Bhavati Tad Garamula Antri. Means that the name, the form, the qualities, the associates and the pastimes of Krishna are all transcendentally sweet. But if someone has avidya, ignorance, then it tastes bitter. So when Krishna's form was in the mouth of Panchajana, he could not taste the sweetness of Krishna due to avidya. So Panchajana coughed and Krishna came out again. Then Krishna began to fight with him and he killed him. And then he took from the belly of Panchajana one conch shell. He found a conch shell. So Krishna's famous conch shell is called Panchajanya. You know, in the beginning of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna blows his Panchajanya. So this is how he took that conch. And Krishna searched, but he could not find even one atom of the body of the son of Sandipani Muni there. Because Krishna was thinking, even if he was eaten, then if I find a little remnant from that, I'll re-manifest the body. So then Krishna came out from the water and he met with Balaram and Samudradeva and he showed them his new conch shell. And he said, I couldn't find any trace at all of this boy. So it seems that his soul has gone to the abode of Yamaraj. So we'll have to bring him back from there. So then Krishna and Balaram got on the chariot and Samudradeva told them the path. Oh, this is the path to Yamalok. And they quickly traveled there to the abode of Yamaraj. Now, it's not a very pleasant place. Has anyone read the fifth canto? Fifth canto Srimad Bhagavatam? Yeah. So there, all the different levels of hell have been described. So there's a hell where the sun is blazing hot and the ground is like copper. And the thousands of people are walking, their feet are being burned, they fall over, they're being roasted. There's Kumbhipaka hell, where the Yamadutas, they're taking people who have been eating Kentucky Fried Chicken and they fry them in oil. They put them in pots and they're frying them in oil. But they don't have gross bodies, they have subtle bodies, so they feel the pain. But they don't die. There's other hells where the Ruru beasts, Mara Rurava, with very sharp beaks, they're tearing the sinners into pieces. I said, tearing out their intestines and other organs while they're alive. There are other hells where people are being crushed between stones. There are other hells where there are torture equipment and the Yamadutas are torturing people. There are other hells where they're being thrown off the top of mountains and they land on sharp grass, which is like razor blades. So, it's a lot of fun in Yamalok. So when Krishna and Balaram were approaching Yamalok, you can just imagine, they could hear all these millions of sinners screaming. Ah! It was horrific. Absolutely horrific. And they got closer and closer and closer. And then as they entered the Yamalok, then Sri Krishna took his conch shell, Panchajanya, and blew. It became more beautiful than heaven. Those who were falling down on the sharp razor blades, all the razor blades became soft. All those who were being boiled in a boiling oil in Kumbhipaka became like a jacuzzi. Very comfortable. The Ruru birds, they stopped pecking the people. And whichever torture, the torture machines broke, the handles came off, they didn't work anymore. And all the suffering immediately stopped, and everyone felt cool and refreshed. And suddenly, from the sky, millions of flower airplanes descended, like a huge flock of birds. And in ecstasy, all those sinners of hell, they're just happily singing and dancing, jumped onto those flower airplanes, and the airplanes were taking off and transporting them all to Vaikunth. And Yamalok was empty. It was empty. When we say that Krishna is pavitra, this is what we mean. Pavitra, pure. Hell was completely empty. And Yamaraj came before Krishna and Balaram with tears in his eyes. He said, "Oh my Lord, for what business have you come to this place? And given your darshan to this cruel person?" Krishna thought, "I heard that Yamaraj is very cruel, he's torturing everyone all the time, but he seems like a nice devotee." He seems like a nice devotee. Krishna was thinking. Yamaraj said, "You must have some special reason for coming here." And the reason was not to deliver everyone from hell. That's not the reason why you came here. Why? Because only the semblance of your name, Namabas, could have achieved that. Gaur Premanande! Understand? Yamaraj said, there was no need for you to come in person to do this miracle of emptying out the hell, because only Namabas would have done it. So please tell me, why? Why did you come here? So then Krishna said, "I'm looking for my guru Dakshina." So my guru's son, he was killed by a demon called Panchajana, and I believe that his soul is here now. So can you just give him back? So then Yamaraj said, "Well, the form in which he's present here will not be pleasing to his parents. So, if you give me permission, I'll bring him and return him to you in a form exactly like the form he was when he was living with his parents." So Krishna says, "Yes, bring him." So then Yamaraj went into his inner chamber and came out with a beautiful, very handsome young boy and gave the boy to Krishna and Balaram. And when Krishna and Balaram saw him, because they have so much love for their guru and guru mata, when they saw his son, naturally, you know, Anani Mamata Vishnu Mamata Prema Sangata. What is love? Love means that you love the object of love, but you love everything related to the object of love. That's the real test. So Krishna and Balaram, they embraced the boy. And the boy was that big eyes, he was looking at the beauty of Krishna and Balaram. He couldn't believe his great fortune. So then Yamaraj, he said, "I think that the real reason you came here is just to give me your merciful glance. Because you can achieve anything only by your desire. Like being in Avantipur, when Sandipani Muni said, 'Please bring back my son,' Krishna could have said, 'Hey son, come on.' Because he's Ishwara, he's Parameshwara, he can't do anything." So Yamaraj said, "I have understood actually, even you did not come here to collect this boy, you came here just to give me your merciful glance. So by your mercy, may my connection with the hell be severed forever." So then,
Yamaraj and his servants, they bought so many jewels and cloth and gifts, and they gave to Krishna and Balaram, and they piled it onto their chariot. And then Krishna and Balaram were leading on the chariot of the boy. And Yamaraj and all of his servants, they were falling behind, dancing and doing kirtan. And then Krishna and Balaram disappeared into the distance. And Yamaraj went back to his abode. He was in complete bliss and engaged in Harinam Sankirtan. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. In the meantime, in Avantipur, the whole city was there, waiting. When will Krishna and Balaram return with the son of Sandipani Muni? With great anticipation. And the chariot was traveling 800 kilometers at very, very high speed. But the little boy, he couldn't understand where he was, how fast he was traveling, where he was going. He was just staring at Krishna and Balaram. How beautiful. And then, in a short time, because their chariot is very fast, they arrived in Avantipur. So when they arrived in Avantipur, thousands of people there were cheering and chanting. Jaya Krishna Balaram, Jaya Krishna Balaram, Krishna Balaram, Jaya Krishna Balaram, Jaya Krishna Balaram, Jaya Krishna Balaram, Krishna Balaram, Jaya Krishna Balaram. Well, wait a minute, I thought they were incognito and no one knew who they were. You see, in the meantime, while Krishna and Balaram were in Yamalok, some pilgrims from Mathura, they were traveling and they came to Avantipur. And by talking with the local people there, they came to understand, oh, Krishna and Balaram, they're not doing austerities in their locked room. They were here all the time. So by the time Krishna and Balaram returned, the residents of Avantipur, they understood and realized their identity. And especially the king of Avantipur, his name was Jaisena. So Jaisen, his wife was named Rajamita. And she was, Raja Adi Devi. And she was actually one of Basudev Maharaj's sisters. So the sister of Basudev Maharaj had married the king of Avantipur. And so that meant that Krishna and Balaram were actually related to them. Right? So she's his aunt. And the king, Jaisen of Avanti, was now realized, oh, I'm the uncle of Balaram. Not bad. So the king was there with all their armies and all their soldiers and a very big celebration to receive Krishna and Balaram. So Krishna and Balaram came and they pushed the boy in front of them and gave the boy back to the mother and father, and they bowed down at the feet of Sandipani Muni and his wife. And they were weeping, they had such tears flowing from their eyes, and they embraced Krishna and Balaram. And Sandipani Muni said, this is a very hardik, marvik, touching point, very touching point. Sandipani Muni said, my affection for you was so bhavik, natural. I thought you were one boy in my cook. You see, when you know that Krishna is God, and when you don't know, it's not the same. He said, and I have done something wrong. Because when there's swabhavik praying, natural love, it never asks for anything. But I asked, can you bring back my son? I should not have done it. Because swabhavik praying, natural love, never asks for anything. Feels embarrassed to ask for anything. He said, now I know who you are. I will yet again ask for one more thing. I simply ask that in every life, in every birth that I take, that we will be your guru and guru mata. And you will be like our sons and disciples. To be related with God, it's okay. But to be related by swabhavik brain, natural love, this is far, far superior. So then Krishna and Balaram, they were crying. And they prayed, oh Gurudev, please bless us and give us permission now to return to Mathura. So Sandipani Muni blessed them. And Krishna and Balaram got on their chariots and they were going from the middle, they were from the center of the city, the palace of King Jayasena and Rajadevi. And they were traveling through the streets of Avantipur. And the king and his soldiers and ministers and Sandipani Muni, his wife and the 1,000 Brahmin students who were in the Gurukul, they were all following Krishna and Balaram. And they followed him through the streets of the city. Everyone was crying and feeling separation. And when they got to the outskirts of the city, Krishna was thinking, they can't come with us all the way back to Mathura. Somehow I have to make them stay. So you know that Krishna speaks very sweet words. Madhuraya gira vagubhakyaya bhutamanokyaya. The sound of his words is sweet like honey. The words themselves are full of enchanting meanings. And even great personalities who have agarda buddhi, vast intelligence like Brahma, they become bewildered by his words. And especially because these words come from his lotus mouth, from his lotus face, and accompanied by the movement of his eyebrows and sweet smile and very beautiful glances. Who can resist the sweetness of Krishna's words? See, Krishna turned to the residents of Avantipur and he said, my dearest ones, Mathura is the place of my birth, but Avantipur is the birthplace of my qualities. Mathura was the birthplace of my body, my roop. But Avantipur was the birthplace of my guru, my attributes. And just as the residents of Mathura, wherever I go, I always see them. From today, wherever I go, I will always see you. And hearing these sweet words of consolation from Sri Krishna, they were stunned, stopped in their tracks. And Krishna took advantage of that moment to drive away. Yes. they know. Bhakti Yoga Bhagavati, Tandama Grahanadidi, the supreme dharma for every living entity is bhakti, and it all begins with the chanting of the holy names. Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama.
Thank you.